Hey, sometimes you should just write in code. How many of you run quality tools? So now I would like to know. So maybe you are not in a position to take a real decision. But how many of you do decision based on metrics for the software? Ah, yes, you could do it. Oh wow, really? Okay. So I just wanted to. I will present you human assessment with Moose. Originally, the idea was that Doro would do the presentations that normally should have maybe today or tomorrow, or we don't need. So, the talk, I will present two things: what is human assessment and Moose, or how Moose fit into the story. So, for the one that who knows what Moose is. Okay, for the other ones, so Moose, this is a software and data analysis platform. So this is developed since 96 now, and won some prizes used by local of university. And I have a duplicate. So yeah. For human assessment, so this is really the work of Doro. So you should go to the website and read what he's doing on that. We are in the process of bootstrapping the companies around the Moose and human assessment. And this is also why I'm doing the presentation, because I think that we need you. But so now let's look a bit. So here, that's much better. When we have a task to do, usually, and software development, ideally the waterfall model would be really cool. This is the perfect model, the waterfall model. You know, if nothing changes and you have all the information, this is really cool because you specify everything, and then after you have an analysis guide, you have the designer, and then there is coder that code, and even people that test at the end, and then you go in maintenance, and life is wonderful, and that's wonderful. That's really a wonderful model, and we are all convinced about that. For things that do not change, that are fully specified, this is perfect. Now life is a bit different. So what is really important is that what we do is that we are really good at taking decisions. And what you see that in all the agile methodology, this is the logo of Scrum for the advertisement, we are really good at taking action and adaptation to what we get. That's the basic principle. So now, in all those methodology, there is something that is really important, this is the feedback. Having the right feedback, this is the thing that will let you make the right decision. And what you want to have a contextual, continuous feedback. Because if this is continuous, then you can lose track. If this is not contextual, it's not interesting. And there is a really nice joke about this is the metaphor of the Zen master. So the metaphor of the Zen master is the following one. So you are in your life, you ask all questions about your kids and your family and your job opportunities and things like that. You go and go and you ask questions to yourself. So what you do is that you go to see a Zen master. You say that to the Zen master, and the Zen master tells you, oh, but the sky is blue and the birds are singing. And yes, the guy is not wrong. Huh? Does it really answer your question? I'm not sure. Personally, not. Because I know that the sky is blue, I don't need the guy to tell me this kind of things. And what you see is that you have a lot of tools that are Zen master around. And the talk today, this is, can we be contextual, dedicated tools that can answer your contextual questions? So, just a bit of a context. So we all know that the software is large and complex, and what I mean by that is that you have a lot of information, a lot more information, and we can generate even extra information. We can have all kinds of tools to generate more information. Just for giving you a little impression, you see that if we take a C++ application, for example, of 250,000 lines of code, and we spend 2 seconds per line just to read it like that and try to get of it just the symbol, it can take a month to read all the code. And this is just a teeny software, because normally now for real application we are more in 2-3 million lines of programs. And for example, I was discussing with people that told me that they work in a company with a really large small talk system, and during 3 months the guy worked and wrote a relational database mapper, and then after he realized that it was already there. It was already in one part of the system. So yes, that can happen. So now if we look at the data are really interesting. So people in the past, in the waterfall model, they were saying, oh, maintenance is... They were calling, oh, yes, sorry. They were saying, the data is that between 50 and 80, and now this is a bit more, % of the total cost of your project is spent on maintenance. And the problem is that you said, okay, but what do they mean by maintenance? If you look at the data, you have 60, you have 18%, so now this is a bit reduced because you have Java and C# and platforms. So let's say 15% is in adaptive to new platform, 20% in bug fix, and 60% is in changing the system to adapt to new requirements. And so what you see that at the end, when the people who are calling maintenance, this is pure development to address new functionality. And I really like the next slide. And it took me a while to understand that people don't understand that. This is, those are burned geranium. So those kinds of geranium, they don't bloom because they are dry. And I was discussing with a company, a large company that has 60% of the world market in a mail distribution system. So some of the machines that they sell are that big, and they push the mail and scan automatically and things like that. And I discussed with one of the developers and I said, how do you improve your system? How do you make sure that you can address the next generation? And he said, oh yes, I discussed with my manager, and my manager said that there was no problem because this was our software. And I realized, oh gee, this guy didn't realize that if he has a dry geranium on his balcony, it will never bloom again, but he can keep it, that's for sure. And it took me a while to really understand that people don't understand that software is a living entity. And how many of you played SimCity? That's really good. That's very important. You know why? Because SimCity, this is the metaphor of software. So at the beginning, you are young and bold, and you say, oh, you know, I will do a nice city with gardens so that the little kids, they can play here, and we'll be ecological people, really happy people, and things like that. And then these people, they said, we want a job, and then what do? You create buildings and roads, and say, ah, shit, now I need to have a boat to bring the stuff. So what's the metaphor? You have to react to context. In SimCity, if you in the original version, I'm not Sims and all that stuff, but in SimCity, the first version, if you want to be successful, you had to always change your decision. You had to always say, oh, this is not that early decisions were bad, this is that the world changed.
You know that Ariane 5 disaster was due to that curve.
Yeah, probably. So, this is just to close the parenthesis, but we have to cope with change. And we have to take decisions due to the fact that the context, the requirement, the technology, everything changed, in fact. So usually you have this nice picture where you say, oh yes, we were doing requirement engineering, then we nicely designed our code, and then evolution happened, and then you have the code that's a bit. And then here, you would have to reverse engineer to extract information. So how the people, they are tools to do that. But basically, what is the problem with those tools is that they just generate more information. So there are tools, okay, you generate more information, and normally there is a guide that should take decision. And this is what we call assessment. Assessment is a human activity. And what you want to do when you do assessment, you want to know what is the current situation and what can we do about it. Those are the two fundamental questions. And what you see the current state of practices, so this is just exaggerated a bit so that the message gets through. This is usually you read the code. You read the code. And what you see is that there are data that says that so now we know that we are losing, that we are spending 80% of our money into maintenance, and there are people that did studies that showed that half of the time spent on maintenance is spent in reading code. So what does it mean? It means that we are really spending the money at the wrong place. And then you have all kinds of other tools. You have these kinds of wonderful tools. They said, oh, you know, in average, in sometimes they said, you have that number of packages in your system, you have that number of class in this package, you have that number of methods in this class, that number of instance variable in this class. And we can generate 100 metrics like that, there is no problem. And you see that the other solution was really... So we have one solution that is really manual and dedicated, because normally you read code in the right place most of the time. Sometimes not. And then you have automated automatic generated solution. And what you want to have, you would really like to have the tools. You would like to have tailored systems that are automatic. And what do we want in addition? In fact, we want dedicated tools that help us. Often, when you arrive with a tool, people think, oh, I will be judged. Oh, my code is bad. I know that my code is bad. Personally, I don't care to know that your code is bad. What is important is that even if you have bad code, maybe you have specific information that you want to extract because it will make you fix your problem. And this idea that the tool will judge your work is something that you should go over, because it's not the point. Some tools are doing that. Some managers are stupid with the tool. They said, oh, all the methods should be less than 20 lines of code. Okay, but maybe let's check the average first and see does it make sense or not. For example, in Arianespace, in the Arianespace project, they are not allowed to remove methods from a class. So when they add a method, it's forever. So of course, if you run a dead code analysis tool, you say, oh, your project is really bad.
Ah, yeah, sure.
So, and then on the other hand, you would like to really have tools, customizable tools that give control and feedback. This means that when you do outsourcing, maybe you want to control certain things that are more than lines of code. You say, oh, the exception in this framework are really well captured. And all the paths to these kinds of things are covered up. You know, something that is more advanced than just some queries. So normally when you do this, we should try to fit the beamer because it's really annoying like that. What's happened when you want to do a task? You will build hypotheses. Oh, maybe I should identify this problem to identify this problem and this kind of stuff. You will apply the analysis, you will interpret the result, and if this is good, you will act. And you see this is in a different color because this is really important. One part of human assessment, this is that your analysis should lead to an action.
Shouldn't there be a line after the act going back to apply analysis?
Yeah, for gravity, that's a recursive, this is all the time. Now, what's happened is that, don't you think that there is something missing? I think that there is a really important thing missing.
Yeah. You want to tell us?
No, you should tell me.
Okay.
What's happened if you don't have the analysis? Because normally, you have really specific things. Like on this project, I have this DSL that is for medical doctor to write kind of Delphi code that will be interpreted on the server, and the client should not write this error there. Do you have a tool that does that? No, usually not. We have a meta tool, but that's something else. So normally, you have, do I have the existing analysis? Okay, if we don't have it, let's build it. And one of the key aspects of human assessment, this is to make sure that we can build tools really fast for that. So for example, if you remember the Glamour presentation at Amsterdam, the WHO would write a browser in 10 minutes, 12 minutes. And this is the idea. This is, can we build a dedicated tool in the, it's a marketing point, so this is probably yet more than that, but can we build a dedicated tool in the moment, in the amount of time that it takes for you to decide, oh, let's go for lunch with your colleague, and there was always one that said, yes, I'm finishing something. And if in this moment where you said, let's go for lunch, and where you really go for lunch. And in this case, it's usually 10 minutes. So the idea, this is really that this part of the story is human assessment. Can we bring dedicated tools so that you, as an end user, can control the result of your analysis and design analysis that are dedicated to your domain and your problem, and not something out of the box that does not really help. I just want to show you an example. So, we wanted to know who is the guy behind this package. We said, oh yes, who is the guy behind this package? So what we have files, this was for Java. We have files and then we have packages. We build a model, files and packages and classes and authors. We build some analysis and we use a rendering engine to display that. So here, a large box is a package, a little square, this is a class, and the color represents a guy. So this means that behind the scene, you have an analysis that we check who committed the most in the system on that file and things like that. So here you see, so we have these kinds of maps because you need some. We are looking for what is X-ray, so we have this map that says, okay, what you see here is that blue is very self-contained, red and green, they have an head and little things around, red the same, and yellow, for example, is the guy that is participating to different projects. And then we apply that on GBoss. And if you see that this is interesting to see, oh, the guy that did GRC10, service, GRC18, soap, oh, XSD, metadata, web service, WSD is the same guy. So maybe we should not lose this guy, by the way. And this was just an example to show you, if this is the kind of information that you want to see, we can do that. I was discussing with a company and the guy said, oh, you know, this was for a C# project. He said, yes, you know, I want 100% coverage for my software. I said, wow, you have a lot of money, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I said, would it not make sense to correlate the bugs with the coverage and to make sure that at least the coverage is better where the bugs are? Because maybe you have a system that is working perfectly and nobody cares to cover it. And he said, oh yes, that could be better. So this is the kind of things, and then in that case, what does it mean? It means extracting coverage information, building maps, what is the bug, and connecting to a bug database, correlating information, building maps for that. So for what the people are doing. And this is where Moose is getting into play. So Moose takes some program, and not only written in Smalltalk, but in Java, in C. So for C, you need us for C#, and slowly we will add things. And Moose, we can compute metrics because every tool should compute metrics. So we have plenty of metrics, just in case you need metrics and you feel like if you start to shake, we can fix one. We can add one metric in 10 minutes. So if you need more, we can really add more. We have a generic engine that is Mondrian for writing really fast maps. We have predefined maps. We have a model browser that you can navigate your entities and things like that. And what is the most important, this is the 3 dots. Because the 3 dots, this is what we don't know that we will do. And for us, it's very important to be able to build tools that we don't know. Because they are dedicated. So for the metrics, we don't care. For the maps, I show you one. So for example, here this is the psychometric complexity that Jorge presented yesterday, where you see, okay, this is a hierarchy, and you have the the size is the width is the number of instances variable, the length is the number of methods, and things like that. So after we have navigation, so for example, here, let's step back. Here we want, this is Java. And what you see is that you have a kind of browser with annotation. So what we did is that we took Java code, we run analysis, and then we annotate. We said, oh, you know, this package contains a Go class. If this is interesting. So we can attach information, and then you can navigate. Oh, okay. So this is the Go class in the package. And then when you click here, you can see the method. Oh, this one is a brain method. So we just took the book of Marinescu and Anza. They provide a bunch of categorization. We just code it and said, okay, what is really interesting is that now with this browser, we can really, really go fast to the point where we want. This means that if people express code, the result of analysis, we can directly show to them where they are in a kind of browser like that. So for the three dots, the key aspect is that it should be the environment. So there is far more. We have a petit parser to parse stuff. We have fame, that is a meta model, so that we can describe different meta model of source code, of author, or whatever. For example, we have different kinds of meta model where we can have basic source code, or we have Eclipse specific meta model and things like that. So for extending, there is a book where you can that is currently being written that explains a bit all the parts. And I want to show you what does it mean. So this means that when we have that at the end, in fact, this is this. So if you type this in a Mondrian browser, if you want to experiment with your domain with something, here I said, oh, you know, I want to have a view, the interaction, I will bring a menu, I want to see little square. The size of a square is the number of methods, the width is the number of attributes, the color is the line of code, and I want to see the line of code within the scope of the class. So like that, there is a linearization. The node will be classes, and from a classes to another classes, I want to see superclass. And you said, oh, and I want to have a tree layout. And when you do that, you get a visualization. So this is just to show you the level of the scripting engine. Then, this is the same for the tools. You all know that kind of tool. And what you see is that you have already this component-like system. I click here, this flow. And then we have a Glamour for doing exactly this kind of thing. So this browser and Glamour, this is 10 minutes, the basic one. So you sit down, in 10 minutes, you have your browser up and running. And there are some more, but I don't want to go too much into the detail. So you see, so what we want to do, we want to empower people here. And our experience with that, this is for non-small talker. Because this is what the small talk community does not really understand, is that there are companies out there that are programming in other languages that are ready to learn small talk just to be able to do those kinds of things. So Doro was giving lectures to people programming in Delphi and Java so that they could script their own tool and do the analysis and extract what were the problems that they had. And he told me that you have need 5 days to get up to speed to understand where to click in moves and what to do with that. And then 25 days to get really control with your life. And then we did an experiment with a large insurance company. They were small talk programmers and they were really excited. So this was cool because you don't have to explain them all kinds of things. And what they wanted to have really new tools to support code integration. Because they had to accept code that was developed and then build tools so that they can understand what they really want to look inside. So yes, you see, so for the Delphi Java programmers, they customized the model because of course this was not the model that we had, because they had a Delphi framework that they developed during 10 years to write a kind of 4GL for doctors so that the doctors can script some of their application. I don't know what a doctor can script, but they could script and they have a lot of scripts. And so we, they need to extend the, to customize the model, to extend the meta model, and define specific rules. So what is really important is that the idea behind Moose, because often people tell me, oh yes, Moose, this is about metrics. Moose is not about metrics. Repeat after me. Moose is not about metrics. It's about dedicated tools. It's a meta tool to build dedicated tools. And this means, I was discussing with a company and they said, oh, you know, we don't even log our bugs, so you are far too advanced for us. And I said, no, that's we are perfect for you. This is completely different because do you want to invest? Because our competitors, this is 250,000 euros a program, a solution. Do you want to invest 250,000 euros for something that produces metrics that you don't know if they are useful? I would say, I would not invest 250,000 euros blindly. So I said, you know, what you should do? You use Moose. He said, oh, yes, you know, I don't know what I want to extract. I will do a pilot. 3, 2 weeks, okay, a month of work. And then after this pilot, I said, oh, now I know I want to load this information in my bug tracking system because like that I will be able to build correlation. So in a venture company in the past that I know, what they were doing something really funny. I was looking at the methods comments, and in the methods comments there was always the bug, the track identification, all this information and things like that. And there was always a funny sentence like, this weekend, this was in Dutch but I could understand, this weekend I went to bicycling. And I was like, wow, what is that? And I asked the guy, why do people they write this stuff in the code? He told me, oh, this is just because we want that the programmer has fun to enter all the other sheet. And like that we can really we let them want feed that we don't care. But with the information of the bug, then what they did after they built its map, where you could see hidden dependencies between their modules and their features. Because they were doing feature analysis because they had a framework for different clients. And like that, they could do feature analysis and said, oh, this is strange. Even if this package does not depend on this one, we have a dependency because each time we have a bug here, we have a bug in this one and in these features. And they were building maps like that. So this is, again, you know, this is part of the story. This is, what information can I extract? Think about my process. And the guy in the company that said, oh, we don't trade. He told me, oh, maybe at the end, when we will use Moose, we will just know that we should buy it. That we should buy these expensive tools. I said, yeah, but in that case, you would have learned something really important. So, in any case, the experience is good. So, this is agile quality also. So, yes, I think that Moose really gives you the opportunity to control your process. Because you have to think, that's part of the deal. So, how does it work? I hate the animation, sorry. So basically what you will do is that you will identify a concern, you will create a rule, you will apply the rule on the system, discuss the result because often you are wrong. And then if we agree or not, we do. And what is important is that you should get a small task at the end. This means that a good analysis is an analysis that at the end, you should know, oh, you should fix this stuff. And I told me, I said, oh yes, maybe, I don't know what it means. I was discussing with a company that Auchan, this is a like Carrefour company, and they told me, oh yes, we bought this really expensive software to produce metrics. We even trained an engineer to understand what the metrics were saying, and we don't know. So for the moment, they just use it to control the outsourcing. They said, okay, we have company developing for us, we run the stuff, we get some metrics. We agree that those metrics, they should be more or less okay with them. They should run the same, and then they accept like that. But besides that, it was surprising. Yes. Sorry for the animation. Yeah, this is what we call daily assessment. So this means that you identify and concern. And of course, this stuff is integrated into a build server. So I just want to show you something. So this is not a bug. This is just that the company does not let us communicate. So here you have a report, which is a native Moose application, In red, you see the rules that are violated. In green, the one that works. When I click on the red one, I will get a list of things. And here, for example, the people who wanted that, not us, they really wanted to have a code flow where here you don't see it really well, but some of them are in shading. And what the shaded path means is that they have some error handling that is not coverable. So this means that as a client, you can press the button and get an error if you follow this path. And why? Because in this system, they have three different kinds of ways to report error, and sometimes it's not consistent, and that's usual. But this is typically the kind of thing that the team developed together. So they developed, they said, those are what is important for us, from the server API, from the kind of things, some of the defined rules, and they wanted to display the results like that because this was what they wanted. And of course, this is integrated into an integration server, so each time they build the system, that's happened. So, yes, you see, so feedback is very important, but having specific feedback is much better. Because feedback, we have always feedback. And this is what we are trying to do around Moose. And now I was thinking that you should be in contact with big project. You should be in contact with big projects that are not written in Smalltalk, because we are not Smalltalk centric, we don't care in fact. If people have money, that can be any language. And as a community, I think that this is really important. So right now you know, okay, Moose can be really a killer app for Smalltalk. Because you have a meta tool, or you can be dedicated tool, if you see the concurrence, we are in competition with all kinds of companies, they are basically running metrics. And you say, yeah, okay, but this is clear that people will evolve to the next generation. That will happen. And for the moment, we are still at the first. And what I wanted to say, because I wanted to start this talk like that to be a bit more provocative, because sometimes I'm a bit sad. Wait, where is this guy? And I'm not sure that the message was implicit, so I prefer explicit message. You know, this is when I was a kid, this was an advertisement. And I guess that if you look at the washing powder advertisement, they all look like that. Oh, mine is more perfume, and mine is wash whiter. So of course you can sell Smalltalk. Oh, with Smalltalk we develop faster. Faster than what, by the way? Faster than what? I would really like to know faster than what, and how do you measure? So we could say, oh, Smalltalk is a cool dynamic language, you develop faster, or dynamic application, and things like that. And in addition, you can maintain all the big shit that you produce. Of course, we will be politically correct, we will not say that it's a big shit, but in reality, this is the case. And we have the solution like behind Moose is this kind of things. We could be much better at marketing our language. Because Microsoft has much more money than all of us here, so, and more record too. So this means that, and you see the power of marketing, because when you see how Java was slow, everybody wanted. So that was my subliminal message. Okay. I'm done. No question? You are still sitting? Yes?
What is the metrics and how it checks the control support?
Right, I think.
Yes, Xavier, yes!
It's the morning, but yes!
I'm wondering.
I am on time, so
I'm wondering if you have a list of all the metrics that the tool supports.
Yeah, we have plenty of them.
Where can I see the list?
Code.
You ask me and I tell you, you know, this is in rules, you open, click, and then if you want, you go to the website of the other company and then you look at the metrics. And I am expert in metrics, you know, I can give you a PDF with 50 metrics with 3 different versions of each, with all the reference and all the justification. This is free on the web. So we are software metrics expert. We are the only one in France, so that's cool. So, but at the end, I think that you need first with metrics, absolute numbers means nothing. So you use ratio. You said, oh, in average, in this application, I have a package with 20 classes. Oh, this one has one. No, that's strange. These kinds of things. And I think that with 5 metrics, you go far enough.
Obviously, we should eat our own dog food, so we.
Can you hear me?
Yes. Okay, good. We should eat our own dog food, so it would be really good if Moose can apply to VisualWorks codebase, Visual Age codebase, Gemstone codebase, and then you'll be able to answer that question faster than what. You'll be able to actually say, look, here are these big projects, and here are the metrics.
Yep.
That would be
you know that Moose was developed in VisualWorks?
Yes, indeed. So I'm thinking that's going to be nice and straightforward. The Gemstone too, they have huge projects.
Yeah. But the version that you have in VisualWorks is old now.
Yeah, I am.
Okay. So for us, we are completely open to all kinds of suggestions. So we can bridge to everything you want.
So for the ones who are asking themselves where they can find information about Moose, there's a moosetechnology.org, and there's a list of tools, and then you can have a description of all the metrics in there. So if you go to tools, which is a third metric item, you're going to find all the information there.
But you should pay attention, and what is on the web, this is what we use, and we have an app. This means that if you try and it does not work, it does not mean that it is broken. It means that maybe you don't know how to use that. So this is part of the business also.
Sorry, I just have to fix something.
Yeah.
We're accidentally getting right